Hello learners, so in this third session about role of history in tourism, we'll focus on the importance of historical tourism. Let me discuss with you the objectives: to analyze the role of historical tourism in the new era, to understand the various forms of tourism attractions which are related with heritage tourism, and also to understand the linkages between historical tourism and religious tourism. We also need to discuss the action plan for promotion of historical tourism activities in the context of use of history. Let us now first understand what is the concept of heritage tourism. Heritage tourism, which falls under the purview of historical tourism, is one of the most popular and widespread type of tourism, and it is among the very oldest form of travel. As we have discussed in the earlier classes, that even the ancient Egyptians and the Rome, the nobility of the medieval times, people were open to experiences to historical places, and they preferred to visit such attractions. We have various interpretations and various descriptions of the concept of heritage, but the most acceptable definition focuses on the tangible and intangible features of an historical landscape. In certain cases, including UNESCO, we have extended the scope to the natural heritage sites as such. This form of travel entails visit to sites of historical importance, including built environment and urban areas, ancient monuments and dwellings, rural and agricultural historical landscapes, locations where historic events occurred, and places where interesting and historical accounts stand out for. The perseverance of his heritage resources had put heritage tourism at the forefront of the industry in many parts of the globe. It is one of the most significant type of tourism in terms of visitors and attractions. This form involves millions of people to visit every year, and due to its major contribution in the global phenomena of tourism, it is considered to be very special form, and it's considered to be the most researched subject in the field of tourism. So, having understood the concept of heritage and heritage tourism, let us understand its estimated global market size. It is widely acknowledged that this form of tourism, which comprises of visiting historical places or heritage sites, is growing at an increasing rate higher than the growth of other form of tourism worldwide. It is estimated that around 20% of the tourists take trip worldwide, which incorporates some form of historical heritage or any such activity. So, you can imagine that the size of the market can be estimated to be over 160 million trips per annum. It is not only refined to special type of tourist who go on a specific holiday to visit a historical or a heritage attraction, but it also comprises of that part of international market which is more inclined and interested in the age group of 40 to 60, looking forward to trip every year to such places. These tourists seek travel experience to understand their knowledge, to enhance their knowledge about other places. They want to experience destinations with a distinctive sense of place. They want to explore. They want to understand and go for an authentic experience in any part of the world. So, all this makes this tourism a very special form. Today, there are a lot of research that is going on. And if we look at the profile of a heritage tourist, we find that this tourist is well educated. Most of the heritage tourists have advanced degrees. Education level is a very significant factor that influences the choice of historical and heritage destinations. Second, these tourists are in a mature age group, an age group between 45 to 65, when they wish to participate in heritage events. They have discretionary income and time available with them. Third major factor is that women, as you know, they are a major decision maker in family vacations and group trips, and they also play an important role in the choice of the destination. This form of tourism is popular among them. International travel is growing. Travelers seeking heritage or historical events are likely to travel to different parts of Europe, Asia, US. This form of tourism is also accountably driven. There is an increase in the cultural exchange process. The heritage traveler is well informed. They look for value for money. They look for an experience that meets their expectations. They are generous in spending. They would like to spend more time and their efforts to understand the attractions, and also are good in spending money on antiques, on old art forms, and on outdoor experiences related to biking or any other activity. They prefer to stay overnight in hotels, in B&B accommodation, and look forward to an extended trip compared to an average traveler. These travelers are likely to visit diversity of sites, cities and regions and look forward to new experiences. However, they want high quality services. They look forward to good infrastructure. They look forward to a good itinerary and are interested in authenticity. They seek to experience the authentic form of culture. They want to learn about the community history and the historical events at the destination. Another characteristic of these travelers are that they are very much friendly. They are accessible to quality travel experiences. They want a unique travel experience that combines education, entertainment, and understanding of the local culture. So now we have understood that this form of tourism is a special form of tourism, and the profile of the tourists are very different. How is this linked with our sector? We have also understood that in tourism industry, we have different forms of tourism, we have different types of travelers, but there is a strong relationship that exists between the heritage traveler and the cultural tourism. The work on this subject also indicates that shopping tourism is also complementary with this form of tourism. Heritage sites are becoming important shopping destinations. Tourists look forward to highly authentic experience in terms of buying souvenirs, in terms of buying cultural products, in terms of various items of handicraft, and they look forward for an opportunity of a cultural exchange in pleasant atmosphere. There are villages which have been turned into shopping complexes based on their historical or natural heritage, and they attract tourism throughout the year and help the tourists to experience the growth of cultural traditions in that particular area. In many cases, renewal of historical areas are also enhanced by shopping. When shopping becomes a catalyst for the redevelopment of inner cities, it becomes a catalyst for the development of the entire environment. So now, let us now move to another form of tourism, which is heritage trails and routes. I hope you must have heard about heritage walks. heritage walks are today coming up in a big way as a experimental model for heritage education. These tools involve physically walking in the area, which allows for personal observation and offers several opportunities to understand the heritage site in its original context. It's a real-time experience. It's a strong motivation for creating emotional ties with the place. Heritage walks are crucial for understanding the meaning and values associated with the local culture. This is an important activity and a challenge because it requires the role of a dedicated and a well-developed team who can answer the questions and concerns of the tourist. To go ahead with this, first of all, engagement with the heritage site is most important. We need to protect and preserve our heritage. We need to come up with measures for conserving them and to help them to retain its authenticity in this time of globalization and modernization. The first and foremost thing is conservation. Second is we must involve the local people involved in that particular area. We must have a cultural exchange with them. We must create an environment of social acceptance. So the purpose of creating these kind of programs is to create awareness about heritage. It also contributes to the development of guiding skills among the tour operators and also help them to experience the local facilities. Many times the program is designed where we use public transport to reach the destination. For example, in the crowded trains of Mumbai, we walk through busy streets exploring new places. It helps us to build confidence among the travel professionals also, and it exposes the tourists to real world situations. This is an interactive and an exploratory activity which promotes development of an understanding about the culture through observation, analysis and critical thinking. Curiosity and interest is initiated during these discussions. It has an influence on the tourist and they can also select specific areas to visit again. Heritage tourism increases the visitors' preservation knowledge in a number of ways. The tourist also discovers the basic principles and the philosophy behind a particular historical object. They visit the site, they understand the conservation and the preservation practices. Many times they are not able to understand the importance of an historical building unless they themselves see and have a first-hand exposure about the various artifacts, for example, the decorative woodwork, the interior walls, the original piece of work. So as a heritage tourist or as a guide involved into it, this form of tourism helps and benefits the entire community. The community also focus on increasing awareness. They focus on the saving local historical resources and the place is well maintained and its authenticity is preserved by the locals. There are a variety of programs today that are launched in different parts of the world and this form of tourism is encouraged. Tourists begin to identify themselves with the destination and it enhances their overall experience. The ethics, the concept of responsible tourism increases. The local population benefits ultimately both in terms of the preservation as well as and in terms of attracting tourists. To develop this, we first need to identify the assets and the resources in our tourism plan. We need to take into consideration both the resources at the public and at the private level and assess their potential as a tourism attraction. Now let me discuss with you the list of various heritage resources which can be included in this form of tourism. They can be historical and archaeological resources such as museums, historical sites, historical corridors, lighthouses, bridges, battlefields, parks, sculpture, monuments, various properties listed in the national registers of the various countries. Along with this, we can also, as I discussed in the previous session, the written records, the documents, traditional dance and music, theatre performances, role of local craftspeople, singers, storytellers are also part of the historical tourism activity. Festivals, fairs, community practices, folk culture are integral part of such activity. Today, the trend is to include the natural resources such as national parks or certain places in the rural landscape or in the wildlife habitat, such as places near rivers, lakes, beaches, which could be also included in this form of tourism. Today, various governments are investing a lot of resources on developing convention facilities and theme parks, various shopping centers and information center facilities for such tourists in and around this area. So after identifying these sources, we need to further focus on the possible themes on which we can develop this form of tourism. Since they are connected with the past for a very long time, we need to understand the profile of the tourist visiting that area. We need to have very good set of guides and interpreters which can project and sell that community heritage to the tourist both at the national and at the international level. A third important integration part between the resources and tourism is the role of community. The community should be willing to offer the resources to the visitors. It is essential that they use the traditional practices. They must make sure that the increased tourism may not adversely influence the cultural ethics and the overall ambience of the environment. As we all know, that tourism has an impact on the resources and it can put strain on the infrastructure such as roads, water supplies and public services. So when we are protecting the historical landmarks and its places, we need to look at its unique qualities and the special traditions and safeguard them for the future and for the vitality of the community. We need to consider these factors whenever we are promoting this form of tourism. The community must be provided with accurate, authentic information. They should be engaged in a way so that the site becomes more lively for the visitors and the tourists. And we know that the tourists would like to select the destination based on number of competitive destinations. So when we are creating and we are promoting such places, it should be authentic. We should sell them through a well-designed brochure or a well-designed website. The service operators and the tour operators should be well informed, and also the itinerary should be prepared and tailor-made according to the needs of the tourist. We need to take into consideration all these factors which overall fits into a particular destination, and also contribution of the local community towards the conservation ethics must be identified. In terms of the type of tourist, it is essential to identify them through various market researches, data available on various websites, the government records, surveys. We need to profile the tourist, consult with the government departments, and also design the activities which are specifically for a specific age group and a type of traveler. So these factors we need to take into consideration whenever we are planning and designing any activity related to heritage tourism. As a student of tourism studies, whenever you go through your book, you will read that interpretation plays a very important role. Whenever as a guide we are interpreting, we are clarifying, we are explaining, we are decoding the facts that the observer or a tourist can understand, effective interpretation helps us to answer the questions. It encourages the tourist to seek information and understand what they are experiencing at a destination. So we need to take into consideration the concept of guiding in this. Guided interpretation services are those services in which the staff is involved directly with the tourist. It includes demonstrations, this may include guided tours, this may include information brochures, presentations, slideshows, and interactive talks. Another integral part of this form of tourism is also religious tourism, because as we have seen in the previous two presentations, that history and religion are linked with one another. Many times we visit a religious destination based on the historical accounts. These places are again related with ancient civilizations of the world, and as I shared with you, India has got so many religious places which are dominated by different forms of religion, and they are an important source of information and are visited by tourists from all age groups. In terms of religious tourism and its linkages with history, we know that we have places associated with various Sikh gurus when we discuss about Sikhism, or we have temples associated with the Jain Tirthankaras, and we have churches of Goa. So on the one hand, these religious tourism attractions attract pilgrimage. They attract tourists from different parts of the world for spiritual upliftment. On the other hand, they are an important source of information for historical accounts. Many international travelers visit these places to understand the Indian religious belief system, the various practices, and to have a spiritual experience and understand the ethical system of India. So as a heritage tourist, religious attractions are an important area. From the domestic tourism point of view, mosques, temples, churches, gurudwaras and religious centers are widely visited by the domestic tourist for both religious purposes as well as many of them have read about it during their school days or in their college books, and they wish to understand the archaeological site, the structure, as well as the background about the particular place. So today government is investing a huge amount of money in developing both pilgrimage tourism and heritage tourism. It is divided into various activities, into various categories. The purpose of all this is not only to promote religious tourism, but also to help them to understand and give an exposure about the historical background. We have the missionary travel, we have, pilgrimage. Other than that, we can have a lot of faith crusades, we have retreat monastery visits, we have extended guest stays, faith-based camps. So all these activities are again exploring the history, understanding the past expectations, the past developments that have come up in a big way today, to integrate technology and the motivation of travel and help the tourists to prepare for an experience which is based on religious lines. We have detailed reports now today on the circuits related to Sufi tourism, or circuits which include, for example, Agra, Fatehpur Sikri, Bijapur, Shirdi, Aurangabad. So these are the places as far as the Sufi circuit is concerned. When we discuss about Christian church circuit, we have the churches of Goa, Kerala and Tamil Nadu. Along with that, we have so many other government schemes related to the promotion of Hindu circuits or promotion of a national integration through the pilgrimage tourism. Places such as Golden Temple or the Sacred Heart Church in New Delhi or in Nizam or the Dargah of Nizamuddin are already developed by the government, and they attract both heritage and religious tourists. The government has identified 35 destinations in the first place and another 90 destinations in the second place to create such centers with basic infrastructure and help the tourists to plan their trips. So, what we have now understood from this presentation is that this form of tourism is a special form of tourism which requires the support of community, which requires an integrated, well-developed, designed plan, promotional activities by the travel agents, and an integration of heritage and religious tourism also takes place at different points of time. The government of India is attracting this segment in a big way. We need to have a holistic package for such sites, where the tourist not only understands the significance of history, the importance of pilgrimage, but also gets an insight about the development and the changes that took place at that particular tourism destination. Today, places such as Rishikesh in Uttarakhand are marketed both for pilgrimage and also for understanding Indian lifestyle or Indian belief systems. So the product is not only for one area, it will be further developed in multiple areas. The objective is to provide a holistic tourism experience. Lot of sites today are using various marketing initiatives. They are training their people, their tour operators and their local travel guides. They are developing and working with appropriate institutional framework to stimulate the growth of this form of tourism. The itineraries are priced at different levels according to the different types of tourists, and the impact of technology is well known in such situations. So friends, in these three sessions of understanding the use of history, we have focused the core areas that we had focused was that history is an integral part of tourism studies. History gives us an insight about how this whole discipline of tourism developed at the global level and at the national level. We have also understood that heritage tourism is a special form of tourism and is an activity which is growing up in a big way. The role of community plays a very important role in this, and in one way or the other, religious tourism is also integrated in this form of tourism. So, along with the community participation, infrastructure is also very important. As we all know that infrastructure helps us to attract tourists and to be internationally competitive. Today, state governments are streamlining, coming up with new circuits related to the growth of tourism in their area. And we need to have appropriate checks and balances to ensure about the safety of the tourist, to minimize the negative impact of tourism on the local environment. These checks and balances can be in the form of instructions, fines or regulatory laws. Specific training should be given to the local service providers who are deriving their source of livelihood from this tourism, and also we need to protect the local culture and environment. So these aspects need to be practiced. We need to review the financial aspects, the carrying capacity of the destination, the local concerns, and and take efforts related with the safety of the tourist. All these factors can help us to promote this form of tourism and to be internationally competitive. I hope you have understood the linkages of history with tourism, and you can go ahead and read about any city in India. You will find that each city has number of historical attractions which, if properly maintained and developed, can attract tourists in large numbers. Thank you.